Welcome back, everyone. My name is Deemer Class, and I'm joined by my co-host, Stephen Rafis. Today, we are thrilled to welcome Boston College women's lacrosse head coach, Acacia Walker-Weinstein, to the fourth episode of the First Class Lacrosse podcast. She graduated from Maryland in 2005 as a captain and All-American, and was on the USA U19 team and the USA senior team, who won gold in 2009. Acacia is entering her 13th season as the Boston College head coach, where she is a two-time national champion and three-time national coach of the year. Acacia has led BC to the 7 straight national championship game appearances, which is incredible, and has coached 3 Tewarton Award winners. Most recently, Acacia has been named the Team USA head coach. Acacia, welcome to the podcast. We're excited to have you.
Thank you, guys. Very excited to be here. Really cool to be able to talk to you guys about lacrosse, learn from you guys, and yeah, thank you for having me.
We're pumped to have you. It's been really amazing to see what you've done at Boston College and gotten to know you the last couple of years and, you know, coached against you for a couple of seasons. And, you know, the fact that even when I was at USC in 2021, and you were going to the finals then, you know, and now, you know, back in 2024, you're winning another national championship, you know, 7 finals in a row. It's been an amazing run, and it's been really awesome to see. You know, congrats, you know, for what you've built and what you're continuing to build at BC.
Thank you. I remember you at USC, and I remember I was distracted during warmups because I was watching one of your dodging drills. And I remember I think it was Izzy McMahon I was watching. And I was like in the getting ready to start the game, and I was like recording one of your dodging drills. I'm like, just get this down quick, get this down. Let my girls see that I'm copying the other coach. It's been a wild ride. And I'm really happy at BC. I'm really happy with the girls. Excited for the season. Who knows what it'll hold, but yeah, it's been a wild ride.
So that kind of leads to one of the first things we were wondering about, you know, as you're prepping for next season. I just saw you guys have a great fall ball scrimmage versus Michigan last week. How do you reset after a national championship game? I mean, you've been in 7 in a row, you've won 2. What's that like resetting for the next season?
We're pretty excited. We lost a very talented, really first class leadership group last season. So that's been a huge adjustment. That was a really impactful class. Those guys, you know, the whole theme of last year's national championship was to bookend their success because they won as freshmen and then lost sophomore and junior year and then won as seniors and then added in 2 ACC championships. But those guys, you know, really shaped a lot of the BC leadership. And so it's been an adjustment to lose them. But every fall, I kind of feel the same way, like, oh my gosh, what are we going to do without the seniors? And it's so different. And then every year, I think the culture, you know, kind of spins things in the right direction. And the coaches, I have a consistent coaching staff, which I think is huge, you know, retaining Sammy and Jen and having Callahan here for now the 3rd year in a row. I think it allows us to seamlessly integrate into the next year and have the culture really create the sustainable, you know, personality of the team. But our senior class has been really great this year. And I always kind of put it back on the seniors and, you know, what's the legacy they want to leave behind. I think the narrative for us this year is we're always trying to figure out some way to get the girls hungry for what's next. And we've never won a back-to-back championship. You know, we won there, you know, 4 years ago, we won last year, but we've never gone back-to-back, which I think is really hard to do. And you know, I believe it's only Northwestern and Maryland that have done it. No, Princeton did that, right? So, you know, we just continue to try to climb to, you know, be among those elite programs. And so right now we're looking to go back to back, although we're not focusing on defending the national title. We're just trying to look forward. Let's win it again. Let's go back to back. So been a good fall. We're young, but, we'll see how it goes.
Well, thanks for joining us. Really pumped to, you know, we're just reading your bio off camera. We're talking about kind of your experience in Annapolis and even going back in the summers and whatnot. So before we kind of go further into BC and, you know, all the recent success that you've had, I just wanted to take a step back. You know, you're at Maryland, you're thinking about your career afterwards. Is coaching always something that you wanted to get into? Did you ever consider another career?
No, I never did. As soon as I met Cindy Timshaw, my coaching staff at Maryland was Cindy, Gary Gate, and Kathy Nelson. And then I had Jen Adams for a couple years too. Just having those four people present in my life every day and, you know, even just looking up to them even before I got to Maryland, they just made me fall in love with everything about lacrosse, including becoming a coach after I graduate. So I don't think there was ever anything else on my radar. I was lucky enough to have those four kind of paving the way, you know, especially with Cindy, and she's still very close to me. And, you know, being a part of the Maryland program, it taught me that it was everything that I wanted to be. I wanted to be just like Cindy. I wanted to be just like Kathy and Gary and Jen. And I wanted to win because that's what they did. You know, they were the first real back-to-back high-level winners in women's lacrosse, and all of them together changed the game between Jen and Gary and Cindy. And that was enough. It changed my life forever.
You know, it's really cool to hear. I had reached out to Cindy as well and just trying to, you know, learn more about you and hear some things. And, you know, she had amazing things to say. And one thing she mentioned that she felt like you always did really well that you've carried into your coaching today is just this ability as a teammate, a coach, to connect with people and be a selfless leader, but then someone that, you know, people truly believe in, you know? So as you reflect on that, is that something that, you know, just came to you? Is that just, you know, is that your parents when you just kind of growing up in a younger, you know, younger age? Like, how did that come about to be your MO? And then how have you continued to try to instill that everywhere you've been since Maryland?
Yeah, well, it definitely comes from my parents and my older brother. You know, I was taught and held very accountable for, you know, being unselfish and trying to, you know, something my dad was really passionate about and my mom really passionate about was, you know, the greatest thing that you can do for someone is to make them believe in themselves. It's to make them feel good about themselves. And I can remember being like in Pee Wee lacrosse and my dad would say, you didn't go congratulate her when she had that big goal. You got to go get her. You got to make her feel like she's on top of the world. And I can just remember over the years, my dad just ingrained that in me as a lacrosse player, as an athlete. And Cindy was like that and Kathy was like that. I think they're just all about making other people feel good about themselves and their performance or who they are. And I think that just makes you connect with people because, you know, I just think it helps you connect with other people and it forces you to get outside of your own self. Don't think about yourself. Think about how good your teammates are doing. Celebrate their success and make sure they know how good they're being. But my coaches were like that. My parents were like that. My brother was like that. And so I don't know, somewhere, I guess it was ingrained in me. You know, I also just think you guys know better than anybody, you know, your success is you're dependent on your relationships. Your success is all about your relationships and the trust with people around you. We don't play tennis. We're not swimmers. You know, we're not doing one-on-one stuff. We're not competing individually. We're competing and our lifeline is our teammates. And if, you know, you don't have trust or a relationship, or if you can't cry with them or you can't hold them accountable, then you're certainly not going to play hard for each other in those tight moments. You know, I was lucky. My coaching staff member, Devin Wills, was my all-time greatest teammate that I've ever had. And, you know, she was like that too. I mean, she and I built our trusting relationship and friendship and teammate relationship based on that. And she was just so great to play for. And I feel like my involvement with US, which started with U19 and went long into my college life, all the US girls were like that too. So I just feel like it was ingrained. It was all around me. It wasn't something I was necessarily good at. It was other people were really good at it too. And now I've just tried to integrate that into coaching. And we build, you know, our BC programs around being unselfish and celebrating other people's success and prioritize them. You know, you give all you've got to 30 girls, then 30 girls are going to give you all they have. And then you've got this great culture of people taking care of each other.
Yeah, it's really special to hear. And I think too, it kind of, you know, a lot of people say like you're a product of your environment. And I think with the experiences that you've had, you know, Maryland and then, you know, coaching at Northwestern and then BC, I mean, you've been exposed, and then USA, you know, you've been exposed to the best of the best for such a long time, right? And then you get this ability to integrate it into what you're doing now, you know, put your own, you know, spin on it. And something that I was intrigued in hearing about and would love to hear more about is I heard this story on another podcast of you meeting Jerry Lynch, you know, and you're reading this book, and this book made a big impact on you. I think your dad or your mom pushed you to go say hi, you know, and then that at the time was like the first like younger kid that he started working with. So, you know, can you tell us more about that and like, you know, how Jerry has influenced you as a coach as well?
Oh my gosh. Yes. I mean, I have his books right here on my bookshelf. I still remember the first time I met him, and Cindy introduced me to him at Maryland. And I just loved everything he represented, just the mental side of the game, you know, mental focus, mental toughness, how it all relates and translates to physical performance. I just fell in love with, everything he said, you know. And he can be, some people are like, what is going on? This guy's, you know, not necessarily my type, but I absolutely loved him. And I watched how Cindy loved him. And I watched the influence he had on those early national championship teams at Maryland. And so, yeah, I mean, I went straight to the bookstore. I bought all the books. I bought every single one. I read them. I was taking notes. And then I was, you know, regurgitating all those things to all my teams and all my, you know, high school teams, because I was still in high school when I met Jerry. But I just think what he's really special, I think he's very talented. I think he sees physical performance and very differently than a lot of other sports psychologists. And he just spoke my language. I mean, I carried that with me when we were at US, all my US teams. We did a lot of his visualizations and meditations. We still do it every single day at BC. I still use his language and use his tactics and stories. And I think he is the best. And I think he continues to still grow. I mean, I think he's with the Warriors now. We still talk. And I actually just got an email from him, and he's always checking in on me. And he'll come and, you know, he'll call me or email me and tell me what he's seeing with our girls. And I still am like, oh my gosh, he's exactly right. I got to figure this out. But I give his book to all my girls when they come in here, when they're in slumps. And, you know, we read chapters together. But he's an incredible mind. I mean, you should, Deemer, do you know him?
No, I when I started, I looked at his website after I listened and saw some of the other names on there, and he seemed awesome. So it's
he is awesome.
What I'm curious about is, you know, hey, you first met him in high school, you know, 10, 15 years later, sports performance, sports psychology, you know, I kind of felt like this with Coach Donowski, like now everyone talks about it, right? There's a lot of different methods and styles, and they can work for different people. So like, what are some of the messages and stuff that ring true for you that you feel like are still so applicable?
You know, I think the biggest thing that I talk to my girls about is if you can learn to control even a little bit what you're thinking about, your thoughts and feelings, just a little bit, just by breathing and meditating first, you can kind of calm your mind. And then from that moment on, you can paint these pictures of how you want to perform. So we spend 4 or 5 months on just breathing and trying to just see if you can focus your mind on just breathing for just a minute. Can you get through 30 seconds without thinking about class or your boyfriend or your girlfriend or thinking about your car or your sore hamstring? It's really hard, really hard. So we spend 3 or 4 months just focusing on quieting the mind. And that practice is teaching you how to control your thoughts. Once you get to that place, I think it takes anywhere from 6 months to a year. Then if you can calm your mind, then you can insert these thoughts and visuals and pictures and, you know, 1v1 moves, 1v1 defensive moves, draws, anything you could possibly think of, 8 meters. and then you can rehearse those moments perfectly in your head. You guys know all this stuff. But that's really what I think 20 years later, what Jerry taught me was to try to control my thoughts so that I could paint the pictures of those reps that I want to happen perfectly, because the mental rehearsal is far better than physical rehearsal if you are good at visualizing. And so I say to my girls, if you're physically tired, then make sure you visualize tonight. See your 8 meter 8 times and then go to bed. And, you know, we work on this a lot, and we've had girls share stories of plays that they, you know, they'll come off the field. I had one player come off the field in a Final Four 3 years ago in tears because she had just scored an 8 meter. And she was like, that was the 8 meter I have been visualizing. And I was like, told you, it works. And she was so emotional about it. And it was really cool. So 20 years later, we're still using that really basic philosophy. I mean, he goes into so many different things for sports psychology, but that's the number one thing that I take. It works.
It's really interesting to hear you talk about a lot of the stuff that goes on off the field, right? When you think about, you know, a player or a coach, you think, oh, well, like X's and O's and they're at practice, and that's really only, you know, 2 hours of the day or so. And it's, and for a couple of weeks in the fall, and then obviously you have your sprint season, but there's a lot of downtime, right, outside of that. And in the fall or the other hours of the day, whether you're in class or you're at home with your friends, then you have winter break, then you have, you know, your whole summer break after season. So I wanted to tie it back in a little bit. You took over the BC program in the fall of 2012, if I'm correct there. And Brad Bates at the time was the Boston College athletic director. I was doing some research on you just before we had you come on the podcast. And he's quoted as still remembering you coming in kind of with the binder for your plans for BC lacrosse. And he's quoted as saying, she already had a playbook as CEO of this lacrosse organization. So I wanted to just ask you about that, right? It's not just the X's and O's that he's talking about on the field, right? It's your plans for this entire thing. You do see it as an organization. You're the CEO of kind of this company that is BC Lacrosse. So just wanted to dive in a little bit to that, what that process was like and just kind of how you view that as a whole.
Yeah, I was really serious about winning way back in the day before we ever should have been winning. But I was really serious about it. And my job for the first 3 years was to convince people at BC why we were going to do it, because they were like, you're crazy. Like this, you're crazy. And I was like, no, we're not crazy. We're going to win a national championship. And they would laugh at me. So I would create these proposals and these binders, and I would tell them the philosophies of everything, always starting with the coaching staff. I've got to build the greatest coaching staff. And I started and still have Jen Kent, which is a huge part of why we're successful. But I had to convince Boston College why we were going to be great, because all I wanted from the very beginning was just a little bit of respect, because we weren't really a program that was paid attention to. And I spent a lot of time in the beginning trying to figure out the resources, the bare minimum resources that we need. I mean, we had one assistant coach, we had no money, you know, we had nothing. And so I approached it from the top down, and I wanted the athletic director to understand my vision so that he could kind of get behind some of my crazy philosophies, because I was operating as if we were national champions then, and we didn't have anything. I mean, people were like, this girl's crazy. But I had to make people pay attention to us at BC. And I think that it caught a lot of people's attention that I had so much conviction that we were going to win. I think some people thought I was crazy. And I think some people were like, maybe this girl knows what she's talking about. But, you know, I just built proposals for retaining coaching staff and getting the people in here that I needed, because I knew that if we got good coaches, then I knew players would follow. And that's really where I started. And I think a lot of people start with the recruits. I wanted to start with the coaching staff, which is why I was very focused on Jen. And then it was just little things, enhancing the locker room. I mean, that was my first big project. Our locker rooms were so bad. And I went out and raised enough money. And I went to the AD and I said, hey, I have this amount of money. I want you guys to redo my locker room. He's like, you have what? And he's like, you did what? I'm like, yeah, I raised it. Can we do it? Can we redo the locker room? And he's like, oh, you know, we should probably talk to development about this. But, you know, I'm a big fan of, and I've had 5 athletic directors. We identify our problems. We identify what we need. I don't go into the athletic directors and say, here's what I need. I need this, this, and this, or I can't win. I say, here's what I need. I have three solutions. Approve one of these solutions. And they're very quick to say, okay. So I had raised this money without anybody knowing. And I said to the athletic director, can you approve this? Can you talk to facilities? We have the money. We have the funding. And we did. And that was one of the first sort of trailblazing things that we did as a lacrosse team, because a lot of other locker rooms looked the same as ours, but I wanted a better locker room. So I wanted good coaches, wanted a better locker room, and we went out and got some recruits. But yeah, like little things like that. I mean, I'm still the same way. I had a call with my athletic director yesterday. I'm like, hey, here's what I need. Can you approve one of these things?
I think going off that, there's so many things that can pull at your attention, right? You've got the on-field, you've got managing the relationships with the girls, which is clearly so important to you. You've got your staff, you know, fundraising, recruiting, you know, how even yourself, like, do you stay organized? How do you lean on your staff and delegate, you know, and how do you, you know, stay on track? Because even just running a business myself, like there's so many different moving parts, right? And I can only imagine as a head coach of a program that you built up, like there's a lot going on.
Yeah, it is a lot. It's hard. Every day is hard. I have three little kids at home. I have an amazing husband, and BC, building BC has been an absolute family affair, I would say. You know, my kids are behind the success. My husband's behind the success. You know, I know what I'm good at in my role as a part of the coaching staff. And I know maybe even better what I'm not good at. And I've been lucky enough to have and retain a coaching staff that knows what I'm good at and knows what I'm bad at. And together, we have built this very cohesive, group of women that balance off of each other. Because I think that my key to building this program and continuing to build this program is letting my coaches do what they're good at. I give my coaches so much autonomy. I let Jen do whatever she wants. I let Sammy do what she wants. I let Callahan do what she wants. They operate with their strengths, but they cover my butt a lot, because I'm very familiar with what I'm bad at, and I'm very clear with them. I need help with this. I need help with this. I'm not a very organized person, and I'm not proud of that, because I'm the CEO of a company, but I'm not this type A leader. I'm quite the opposite. And so I think for a while, that was the reason why we were losing those championships early on, is because I was, you know, focused on the relationships and being creative and dreaming big and getting people behind our operation. And really the operation was suffering organization. And I realized that after the 2019 loss, when we lost to JMU out in Stony Brook, I realized, I'm like, I don't understand how this has happened. Like, you know, we should be winning. And we really took a deep dive, and we figured out who we needed to bring on staff and get more help to help with the organization and the operation of the program, that we were the real deal. And we couldn't just play with house money. We couldn't have that same philosophy if we were actually going to go and win these things. So, you know, my staff does an incredible job. They are the key to the success. And I think we just accept each other for what we're good at and what we're not bad at, or what we're bad at. But I just try to be myself. I don't try to be somebody I'm not. I'm not this type A leader. It's just not who I am. I'm not great at writing emails. I will forget text messages. I will, you know, scheduling's not my thing, but my coaching staff crushes at that stuff. So we all kind of work well together.
You mentioned your staff, and Jen Kent's name came up a couple of different times. I just wanted to focus on her specifically. BC, you have one of the best, if not the best, defense in the country. She's obviously done a tremendous job down there. I think if there was a head coaching position opening in the next year or two, right, or whenever, people would always think that, yeah, she would be the person to take it. Like, I don't know, that's something that she wants, but you have such a great defensive coordinator on staff with you. Could you just talk a little bit more about her and how huge of an impact she has made for your team?
Jen is brilliant in how she builds a system. I mean, she's very talented in terms of defense, personnel, systems, scouting, but she's also the mom of six incredibly talented, incredible humans. She's very smart about adolescent kids and teenagers and, you know, college kids. She's very smart. She's very, she's hard on these kids, but she loves them just as much as she is hard on them. And I think those two things make her so good at what she does. I mean, I think a lot of people think she's just all systems and X's and O's, but Jen is an incredible connector with people and with our girls. And she builds these relationships where she's hard on them and holds them accountable, but she knows how to pull the most out of each kid. But I'd say overall, I mean, I think over the last 7 or 8 years, we've had a lot of incredible individual players, a lot of incredible units, a lot of fancy offensive players with Charlotte and Sammy and Kenzie and, you know, Rachel Clark and Kayla Martell, all these incredible offenses. But when you look really close, the stabilizer of our team is the defense. And it has been that way for many, many, many years. And I give all the credit to Jen.
I think going off that too, I think when it even comes to recruiting, you know, a lot of people can go to a field and see the players that have the stick skills and the behind the backs and things like that. But when you look at some of the players that have been those defensive impacts or middle of the field impacts, they're not names that were always coming up as much. You know, like I remember we were actually even recruiting Shea Baker against you guys, you know, and I think that was also, it was the COVID year. So it was like a little funky, but it wasn't a kid that like everyone was talking about all the time. And then here she is, like one of the fastest kids in the country, one of the most lockdown kids. And you put that on top of like Sydney Scales and, you know, even the impact Dempsey had, you know, going from defense to midfield. So I think that also, you know, speaks to her and you guys as a whole in terms of recruiting and finding the just the right people, not the most people, but the right people.
Right. Yep. And I think another thing that Jen's really good at is figuring out who's on the incline, like who is about to get even better. Because, you know, there's so many good lacrosse players out there. You guys know there's so many good players, but you got to find the kids that are going to get significantly better during the 4 short years that we have them here. Like when you think about Sydney Scales, I mean, she came from Boston, Walpole, small town kid, hardly any teams were recruiting her. I mean, she obviously got recruited, but, and our club coaches, Sam Taylor and Tracy Sullivan, they call me and they're like, Akeisha, this kid, you gotta watch her. You gotta watch her. She's going to be the next big thing. And luckily we got Sid, but you know, she wasn't this big highlighted kid. And look at what she did for our team. And look what she continues to do. And now she's coaching and changing Harvard. And it's just, it's exciting. So, you know, yeah, I mean, she's a great recruiter. She works very hard. She loves it. That's the thing. She loves it. She loves finding new talent. She loves finding obscure talent. She loves developing relationships with those obvious kids to see if they're going to be a good fit for BC. She does a great job. She is a very, very, very important, very critical part of this recipe at BC. Nothing would happen without Jen here.
Yeah, so I want to kind of segue some of that around the recruiting. I also think the last several years, you know, the transfer portal's been very topical. And I think between recruiting and sometimes the unknowns of, you know, transfers coming into your program and not knowing how they're going to fit and mesh, I feel like when we even zoom out and look at the landscape of men's and women's, I mean, the success you guys have had in the transfer portal as well and bringing these kids in and then, you know, playing what you would call BC lacrosse, you know, and the success, you know, I can't stress enough that that's not easy to do. There's been a lot of great players go to great programs and, you know, it hasn't lifted the team, but it clearly has for you guys and some select players like Charlotte, you know, Rachel, Emma last year and others. So, you know, how does that process work? Like, how do you, you know, one, identify the right people, but then bring them into your culture and get them on the same buy-in and belief that you've been talking about this whole podcast?
Yeah. You know, I think with Charlotte, I missed her the first time at recruiting. And when she went into the portal, I was like, I will not miss her the second time. And, you know, Kayla and I went crazy over her in the portal. Charlotte's an easy one. Rachel, even Becky Browndorf from last year, Rachel Hall, our goalie for our first national championship. all these girls have one thing, two things in common that work here at BC. They're unselfish. They're very unselfish people and players, despite their star power. Like, you look at Charlotte, and yeah, she's a ball carrier. She's a quarterback. She has the ball in her stick, but she is incredibly unselfish. That is her intangible. A lot of people think it's her windup or her stick skills or her speed of her shots. I know Charlotte. She's unselfish. And that type of competitive energy reverberates around the team. And same thing with Becky last year, or Rachel. Like, Rachel's similar. She has the ball in her stick a lot. A lot of people think, oh, you can't be super unselfish if the ball's always in your stick. What's far more important, like, you got to look, how do they act in between plays, in between games, after losses, when other people are the star? And these girls, they all have unselfish competitive energy, and they all have one thing on their mind: they want to win, and they'll do anything to win. Anything. I think we've been lucky enough. Those girls that we've gone after in the portal, we have told them that this is the way here. Nothing's going to change. And if you can't change into this mold, or if you can't fit into this mold, it's not going to work. And those girls, it was already who they were. So I think we had a little bit of, the transfer portal gods are looking after us, but we had really good luck.
Well, you did. And real quick, I just wanted to add to that, you know, the comment about Rachel that kind of strikes me too, because we were texting last spring, you know, and you were before one of your games, and you made this comment, like something around she needed her teammates' permission to go off, you know, and that could be like a shifting moment for you guys. And obviously it was, you know, she exploded like kind of middle to the end of the season. And that, you know, that kind of speaks to that unselfish mindset you're talking about.
Yep, it is. It's the key. It's the way here. It's the only thing that can get you over the hump in those really tight moments. I mean, games tied 12-12, you know, 4 minutes left on the clock. The unselfish group of young women are going to win most of the time. And I believe that because it's like you looking around and they're your lifeline, and you know, there's no individual egos, or this person needs their numbers, or this person's got to get their goals. I mean, we try to shut that stuff down because it'll kill you in those moments. You guys know.
Yeah. You talk a lot about, you know, being unselfish, and we're talking about your star players, right? A Charlotte North, a Rachel Clark, people like that. There's a lot more that goes into a team than just the star players, right? We're talking about that with the defense as well. Are there any players that stick out, you know, the past couple of years? It could be in the championship last year, or, you know, 2021, like those glue type of players that, you know, maybe they're not an All-American. Maybe your average person doesn't really know them or notice them on TV, but for you guys inside the BC locker room, that they are just completely instrumental to your team's success.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. There's so many. I mean, last year, I think, you know, our unsung hero was Mallory Hasselbeck. I mean, this girl has been through the ringer with different injuries, but she's the glue to our team. And, you know, she and, you know, Michaela O'Connor and Lila Trussell, I mean, these kids in the locker room are lifting people up, reading the game plan, reminding people about what to do, you know, watching clips at halftime. I mean, these girls are completely and utterly devoted to their teammates' success and to the team's success. But we've had those players along the way, you know, all over the place. I mean, I wish I had a couple of rosters in front of me, but, you know, I would say this unselfish thing, just to go back really quick, the unselfish thing, it started with like our early teams, you know, our 2017 first national championship team, with players like Kenzie Kent. And Kenzie Kent was the most unselfish player in the world, but she finished in the national championship, I think with like 9 points, and she's the only MVP to ever win the MVP on the losing team. But players like Kenzie and Sam Apuzzo and Kate Weeks, Kayleen Hart, Dempsey, you know, all these girls, they were all just so nice and unselfish and these kind people with this killer instinct energy. So anyway, I didn't mean to go back, but I had to give those guys credit because they kind of paved the way. But yeah, I mean, those players are everywhere on everyone's rosters. And I think it's important, really important, for not only the coaches to figure out who those players are, but the girls to figure out those players. And we've had some really impactful people in the locker room in the past few years. Those girls, you don't win without those girls. And It's really hard being on the sideline, and whether you're just not playing because you're not playing or if you're fighting an injury, it's really hard. And so the buy-in is the real test. And we've been lucky, the coaches have been lucky enough to look to the sideline. And sometimes those kids on the sidelines are more bought in than the kids on the field. And that's always a good thing. So, again, it goes back to the culture and team first, be unselfish.
How do you take the unselfish mindset, but then go about trying to develop that killer mentality too? You know, because you need to have that hyper competitiveness, you know, to beat out all the teams week in, week out that you're playing against, and kind of have some of that alpha mentality too. So how does that go into your messaging and the belief that you're trying to instill in them?
I rely a lot on the girls to help me with that because, just take, a defensive unit, for example. If our defensive is a little bit harder to explain, let's take four attackers. I rely on, let's say we're talking about Rachel Clark. I rely on Emma, McKenna, and Kayla Martello to do whatever they have to do to get Rachel to be okay being the star and to be okay going to goal. And it can't just come from me. It's kind of what you just said, Deemer. It's giving your teammates permission to be great. And then once they realize how great they are, we then communicate to them, this is now your job. Rachel, you have to go to goal here. This is your job. You're not being selfish. Your teammates believe that this is your moment. And now your coaches are saying, this is now your job. So you've been given permission by your teammates. Your teammates are focusing on what makes you successful, Rachel. And now coaches are saying, now this is your job. Now go do it. And if you don't do your job, you can't be on the field. So you got to kind of balance it. But I think we rely a lot on their teammates. Like, find ways to lift each other up. Kind of like what my dad always says, like, you got to find reasons to make other people feel successful. Find reasons to make people feel good about themselves. That builds a little bit of confidence. It gives people permission to be great. And then the coaches come in and say, hey, now we need you to do this because this is your part. This is your job. This is your piece of the puzzle. And we hold their feet to the fire on all those things. But really, the bottom line is that the girls are focusing on each other's strengths. Give them permission to be great.
I love that. Takes the emotion out of it, too. Like, it's more black and white. Like, it's not, we don't feel like this. It's just, hey, this is what we need you to do. And if you do it, we'll be successful. And you have the track record to show that.
So we've heard a lot, about the BC culture, whether it's in one way or another, unselfish people, how you get the best out of these girls. I think anyone that's tuning into this podcast, right, they see your name pop up that we had you on, and they're going to be curious about probably the biggest stat that stands out. I know you've won two national championships with BC, but you've been to seven straight national championship games. That's unheard of. Like, it's incredible. Something that you and BC should be very proud of. Could you just talk to us about that? I know it's not a direct question, but it's been seven incredible years. Super impressive. You've had a lot of different talented players. We touched on the transfer process. You've had good defenders, good offensive players, good goalies, draw girls. It's been a whole thing. So could you just tell us what these past 7 years have kind of been like for you?
Yeah. It's crazy that it's been seven straight years. I don't think about it that often. The only way I really think about that is I'm just glad we're 2 for 7 instead of 1 for 7. 2 for 7 sounds a lot better. No, those five, they bother me all the time. I think about them all the time. But as cheesy as it is, I do think that if we hadn't gotten our hearts broken a couple of those years and, fallen flat on our face in front of everybody, you don't figure it out. You never figure it out. And I think our second championship, actually our first and second, were a product of us feeling embarrassed. I felt like a failure for a long time. I was like, what am I doing wrong? I'm getting us to the finish line. I can't figure it out. Like, what is my problem? I was blaming myself a lot. But those five championships that we lost, and the biggest thing I think about are the seniors that didn't get that senior championship. But I do think when you look at the program overall, the 7 years of championships and two championship teams with two ACC championships, I do start to think about it as more of a big picture thing. And I think the alums appreciate that. The families appreciate that. I think the school appreciates that. I think the only two other programs that have seven in a row are Northwestern and Maryland. And I, you know, very passionate about both of those programs because I got a lot of great experience and exposure with them. I don't know. It's crazy. It's hard right now with how good everybody is. So I think that's what makes me the most proud is that it's happening in a time when so many teams are so dangerous and so good. I mean, so many teams can win. I mean, look at Denver and, you know, UPenn and Syracuse and obviously the usual suspects, Maryland and Northwestern and Carolina and, you know, but everybody's good. So I think that's what that makes me proud is, you know, that we're having this success when there's so many really good teams. But it's been a wild journey. I feel really lucky to have been a part of it and we want more. Like we want to win. I want to win again. I mean, you get crazy. Like, I don't know who said it, Coach Pop. I don't know if it was Coach Pop or someone that said, oh no, who was it? Somebody said, you know, he was giving advice to someone for their first championship weekend. And he said, either way, you're screwed after this. Who said this? Either way, you're screwed after this. Either you win and you become fully addicted to winning or you lose and you're mortified and you become fully addicted to winning. So good luck either way. And that's, I totally get it.
I'm looking this up for sure after.
I like it. Who said it?
I can't think of the name either, but I've seen the quote.
And I'm like, oh, I know exactly how he feels. Because you do. You get very, very obsessed either way. And, you know.
So I think too, and I feel like I've heard you talk about this before, but and maybe it was one of the, you know, post-championship interviews. It had to have been really validating for the players that committed to BC before, you know, they won one, you know, that were a part of what you built. And I even think, because I know the family just through high school, Covey Stanwyck, you know, who again, you know, kind of did something different than a lot of her siblings and going to, you know, a less traditional power at the time and, you know, Michaela Ricks, et cetera. So, you know, what is that connection like to the alumni and those that were, that kind of came before all the championships?
Yeah. I mean, Covey and Michaela changed everything for BC. I mean, a lot of people think the success happened, you know, 2013 on. You know, I give a lot of credit to Bo and Holden and Jen, who was here. Jen went crazy to get Covey and Michaela. I do think those guys really started something special because those two choosing BC over everyone was crazy. That was crazy. And it started a little bit of a trickle-down effect. I mean, Covey and Michaela, and then we really took our biggest steps with them. I think that was when we went from, you know, not going to a national championship. Their junior year, we went to the Elite Eight or something like that. I can't remember. I'm getting old.
Yeah, I think I saw like Elite Eight and then you started being in the mix.
That's huge.
Maybe a top three ranking the year after or something like that.
Yep. And we also had Sarah Manley, who was with us during their time. And she was our first ever Tour Ton finalist. And, you know, she was a basketball star. And I remember recruiting her and, you know, the three of them really took us to the next level for sure. But again, I'll tell you a cool story about Sarah Manley. One of my favorite stories ever of BC lacrosse ever. So we're down in North Carolina. We have Michaela, who's just running back and forth as a two-way middy. Sarah Manley, two-way middy. And Sarah was a baller. She was a basketball player. She could like hardly cradle, but her vision was sick. Her defense was sick. And I mean, she could cradle, I'm just teasing, but, and then you have Michaela down on the attacking end and we're playing Carolina and we have no business winning. We go down there and I think there's like, I don't know, a couple minutes left in the game. And, I think Covey shot it for like the tying goal and she missed. And I remember everyone was like panicking. We were like, oh my gosh, or I can't remember that's exactly what it was. Then Carolina got the rebound and went all the way down the other field. I probably should not be saying this, but went all the way down to the other side. And all I remember watching was Sarah Manley running 100 miles an hour, 100 yards, and chased this girl down. Just, it was the most beautiful, like, it was like art. like chased this girl and caught up to this Carolina. Nobody catches up to Carolina kids, right? Chased her down, caught her, back checked it, picked it up, sprinted the other way, and got it right back to Covey. And it was just like, here, Covey, you get another shot. Like, you get another chance at this. And Covey finished, and we won, and there was a diving save at the end. But I just remember, like, Sarah was just like, I'll do whatever it takes so that Covey can have this second chance at tying this game that would make her career. You know what I mean? So, like, I'll never forget those moments. Like, that's why Sarah sticks out to me. And, you know, again, just unselfish. Like, here, I want you to have another chance at this. Like, she didn't care if she scored. She was just going to go get that ball back for Covey.
Yeah.
One of my favorite memories ever.
That's awesome. I think it's really cool to just listen to you talk about, you know, BC lacrosse. And I know BC lacrosse was a thing before you got there, but since you've been there, it's really become what it is now. I played at Syracuse, and, you know, once I was there, like, it's already been a dynasty. There's 10 national championships. There's all the famous names. So you just kind of hear about the stories and whatnot, but you guys are kind of in the process of, you know, building that dynasty. And these types of names we're talking about, you know, Stanwyck, Ricks, Charlotte North, the players that you have now, like, these are going to be names that we're going to keep hearing about, you know, the next 10, 15, 20 years. So I just think that's really cool, the stage that you guys are in now. One other thing I wanted to ask, obviously, like I said, you've been in the national championship games 7 years in a row. When you turn on the TV, can't help but notice all the neon in the stands. You take a look at that, the players on the field, no one is in neon, right? Your jerseys aren't neon. So where does that come from?
Just my neon water bottle. Actually, it all kind of started in high school. Me and my girlfriends from Annapolis High School kind of had similar colors. We were maroon in high school, and I just loved this neon green. I just always loved it, and we would wear these big neon bows, and then that kind of went away, obviously. But then our first championship, when we went to Gillette, again, we were kind of a Cinderella team, and I just remember thinking, we're going to be in this huge stadium playing against all these big time teams, and maroon doesn't really stick out, right? And I just remember thinking, like, I want our girls in Gillette to be able to look up in the stands and find their family and know that their fans are here, because we're in Boston. There's a lot of little girls here, a lot of families. I knew we were going to show up. And I just wanted our girls to be able to look up and find their families and see that there's an actual BC crowd here. You belong here. You're supposed to be here. And so I remember, I think my husband and I bought like 500 neon shirts, and we just gave them to the families, and we're like, give 20 out to everyone you know. And that's kind of where it started. And I think a lot of people loved it. I think a lot of people kind of hated it at first because we weren't winning with the neon, and they were like, it's a curse. And I was like, no, we got to stick with this. Want you guys to see your families. I want you to be able to look in the stands and see the sea of neon and have it stick out. And slowly it stuck, and the athletic directors got behind it, and the team got behind it, and we've stuck with it. And now a lot of our stuff is neon. It's a big BC staple.
Those football stadiums too. I mean, it's always interesting because you got some sections where, you know, obviously no one's there. Like, we played in M&T and Philly, and you got the upper deck. But then when you get everyone lining up like one section, yeah, like, you're seeing all different kinds of stuff. And I always think too, like, sometimes kids can find their parents, like, you hear the voices, but then when everyone can see like their support system, it kind of lets you relax, you know,
it and does, settle you relax.
Just play lacrosse.
And for a long time, we didn't have a huge fan base. And over time, it grew. And it was important to me that the players on the field could look up. I mean, I'll never forget at Hopkins. I mean, there was 11,000 people there. Like, I think we had 6,000 fans in neon, and or 5,000 fans in neon. I want our girls in that moment to feel the power. Look at what you've done, girls. Look at all these people that are here to support you. And I don't know, sometimes stuff like that matters to me. Maybe it's a distraction. I don't know. But I just think it's important for them to take a look around and see what, you know, they've built, and how excited people are to watch BC.
I think it's also an interesting thing to connect to. Exciting news this week with the launch of the Women's Lacrosse League. You know, you're going to have a lot of players that will continue to play at multiple levels. You know, we've gotten to know some of them, like all amazing people, amazing players. Like I've loved watching Sam and Dempsey and Charlotte and Kenzie over the years and many more. You know, so talk a little bit about like just the future of the sport and, you know, having, you know, more platforms for younger women's players and just younger women to watch and aspire to.
Yeah, I think it's a huge step forward for the sport. And I think with the landscape right now heading into the Olympics and, you know, adding all these disciplines in the U.S. program, it's just another step in the right direction. I love Rachel DiCecco and Paul Rabel, and I don't know all the names involved in this initial launch, but I trust them. I think they don't get behind something that they don't plan on succeeding in. So I'm really excited for them. I'm excited for the girls to have another platform. I'm excited that young women can have, you know, another pro league to look up to. And I just think the whole day down in New York was so impressive. Just everything that they got to do, just being, you know, in Times Square and being on ESPN and, you know, just how well-spoken those girls are and how well they articulate their passion and their vision for the future. I just think it was really well done. And to me, it feels like, you know, there have been a lot of attempts at doing the Pro League, and AU has been great also. I just think it felt like it's time. I mean, look how big of a deal that was. That was a really big deal. And I think it's really exciting.
And seeing Charlotte in so many of those too.
Oh my gosh. I mean, I texted her. I was crying on my couch watching her with my daughters. Just listening. I mean, I could get emotional right now, but I'm just so proud of what she's done for the program, for lacrosse and for all these little girls, and to just push the program forward and have so many people follow in her footsteps. And it's just so exciting. It's so good for the game. And I think we're in a really good place right now with women's lacrosse.
Yeah. And you're a part of something else post-collegiately, and maybe you'll have some college players, but you've recently, this past spring, you've been named the Team USA head coach. Could be possibly your biggest accomplishment, and we've listed a lot. What is kind of the process like for that? What's your vision for Team USA? I know you talked about, you know, when you're building out the BC program, the first thing you focus on was the coaches. And no, you're not recruiting necessarily for Team USA, as all the top players are going to want to play for them. But are you having that similar approach, you know, building out the coaching staff? What's your vision there?
Yeah, that was my first move. I was like, I need the most amazing group of women with me, you know, and I have my ideal coaching staff. I'm so excited. You know, I'm coaching again with Kayla, which is great to kind of reunite with her. I've got Devin Wills, who is my team, longtime teammate. I've known her for so long. I have Melissa Lehman, who I think adds a spark. We aren't as close with Melissa as I am with these other guys, but that was on purpose because I wanted to learn from her and, you know, have someone new and sort of outside of my direct bubble come in and kind of teach us and help us. I have a lot of respect for what she's done at Rutgers, and I have a lot of respect for her as a player, and I think she knows exactly what she's doing. And then I have Jen by my side, which is great. And I definitely, that was the first move, because I think it all will stem from, everything will stem from the coaches and what our philosophy is and how we treat the next 2 years. But I'm so excited. This weekend is our first training weekend, bring 44 girls down. And we're going to build it very similarly to what we do at BC. I mean, it's the unselfish competitor that we're looking for. And, you know, I want to make sure that, you know, we do a couple of things. I want to honor the tradition that we've had over the years and building off of what has already happened and what used to happen, and then elevate everything moving forward, elevate the coaching, elevate the operation, elevate the travel, elevate the brand of lacrosse. And, you know, we want to build off of all the great things that Jenny and her staff did in the last World Cup, and then put our spin on things and change a few things here and there and build our own team. But, you know, we're never going to, I think the biggest thing that's going to be hard is I think some people think this is like a cruise control job. Oh, you've got, you know, all these Ali Mastriani, you've got Charlotte North, you know, you've got all these incredible people. but we're not going to rest on anything. We're not going to rest on talent. We're not going to rest on history. I want things to be different for this team. I want to raise the overall standard and expectations. I want to be the greatest women's USA national team that's ever existed.
It's really cool to hear. And, you know, last week we had Coach Tillman on from Maryland, and, you know, he was talking about at Maryland, like they have the be the best mentality, and he didn't start that, but they've built on it. Right. And so, you know, when I hear you talk about and how passionate you are about these teams, you're not happy just being, you know, good or good enough. You're trying to be, you know, the best possible version of you and your staff and the team. And, you know, when you have, you know, again, 40, 50, 60 of some of the best players in the world trying out, you're going to set a high bar, you know, and you've had your own USA experiences. So I'm just excited to see, you know, what you do with that opportunity and how it evolves.
Yeah. I mean, have you seen the roster for next weekend?
I've seen some names. Yeah.
Isn't it awesome? I'm so excited. Yeah.
And you see some college kids mixed in there, and so many like recent grads, kids you've coached against. Like,
I love it. I am so excited. I've got a coaching call with my staff this afternoon, and we're gonna plan our first practice. And I am so. I was just doing some of the groupings, like for stations or not stations or groups, and I'm like, oh my gosh, look at this group. I'm just drooling over the midfielders, of course, because that's where my passion is, but. Yeah, I'm so excited. I think it's going to be really difficult to get this squad down to 22. But I love the group. I think we're going to have some really difficult decisions to make, but I'm just excited because the coaching staff, we're so aligned on what we want. I mean, all of us have the same passion for the foundation being unselfish, and egos, they got to go. Like there's no time. We just don't have time. I don't care who you are. We have no time for egos. That gets in the way of elevating everything. And so I know I have a hard job, and I know I'm going to have a really, really, really hard time with this, but I'm excited for the honor, and I love the group of girls.
Keisha, well, I think with that, we'll look to wrap up here. I just want to thank you again for your time. And, you know, we loved learning from you today and really think highly of you and what you've built, and, you know, excited to keep getting to know you and see all you do at BC, USA and beyond.
Well, thank you. And Deemer, I told you this, I think you're one of the greatest minds out there, and I love what you've done. And Steven, I loved you as a player. I don't know you as well, but I'm sure you're just as great. But thank you guys for having me, and anything I can ever do, let me know. And if you guys come down next weekend, text me and come to a practice. Tell me what you think.
We'll be there.